We're going to do something a little bit different that some of you may not have, may have grown up something like this. So I need all the kids. Come here for a second. Come on up here. You guys just come up here in the front. If you're, yeah, just come on up. So, yeah, you can set here or set on this. We got a lot of kids. Okay. Scoot. You guys can sit close together. So do you guys remember whenever we used to do children's messages with kids? And I've always learned that the parents get more out of it. Like, you'll remember this more than you'll remember my message. So we're going to talk about why I have this flashlight. I just bought this flashlight. It's pretty cool, ain't it? So, but it doesn't work. I just bought it. It's brand new. It needs what?
Batteries.
Yeah. Okay, let's see if that works. Think that'll work if I put batteries in it? All right. I just happen to have one. How about that? I only have one battery. Is it going to work with just one battery?
I think so.
You think so?
Yeah.
No? Maybe? Yes? Okay, so it works pretty good, doesn't it? Not only does it have a battery, it has a battery that I can charge up over and over and over again. Isn't that pretty cool? So I don't have to ever buy batteries again. I can just use this battery and charge it up over and over again. You know what? When I was a kid, I used to be scared of the dark. Any of you guys scared of the dark? Yeah. And I remember my parents had a little bitty thing called a nightlight. Any of you got nightlights in your? And it was just enough that I could see and make sure that nothing was there was scary, right? But I also, if I had to get up, the rest of the room was dark. So guess what my parents gave me?
Flashlight.
Oh, yeah. So I could look around and I wouldn't fall into things. But a flashlight isn't any good without batteries, is it? You'd be just as dark as you was before. We're going to talk about that today. The old people, I'm going to use big words and stuff, but we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about what it means to have a battery in our life. What do you think that means whenever we talk about the battery? What battery should be in our life? This is a Sunday school answer. Jesus. When Jesus is in our life, we are the light. That's what the Bible says. We become the light of the world. So guess what? We can't hide that light either. When it's shining, it's hard to hide a light, isn't it, in dark? It just shines. And that's how we're supposed to be. But we're also supposed to charge ourselves through studying the Word and prayer. So can we pray? Heavenly Father, Lord, I pray for each one of these young people today. Lord, you know them, you know their families, and Lord, I just pray that they will come to a relationship with you, that they will put you in their life, Father God, that they'll recharge on you daily, and Lord, that you'll use them to shine light all around them to keep others away from danger, and we pray this all in Jesus' name, amen. Okay, you guys can go back there. So we decided it would be fun if on the first Sunday of every month we had a family day where we bring the children in for worship and we do a little sermon for them and kind of build them into being used to being in church. So you're going to kind of see that every first Sunday. And also, every quarter, the first Sunday will also be our communion Sunday. So every quarter. So they'll also get to experience communion with us too. So they'll get to see what that's like also. So it's just a little change, but a fun change, I think. And a time where we can bring them in. So today we're again in 1 John. 1 John chapter 4. We'll begin in verse 16. And the word I have today is perfect love casts out fear. We're getting ready to go into this Christmas season. aren't we? You know one thing I noticed about Christmas? Anxiety. Man, people are anxious around this time of the year. It is probably one of the biggest times of the year that, therapists, psychologists, social workers, they are busy trying to get people back on track. We have so much depression and so much anxiety in this world. I looked this up. Do you know that 20% of the nation is on anxiety medicine? And by the way, I'm grateful for that. Please don't take it like I'm saying that. I'm grateful that people are reaching out for help and not just trying to do it on their own, because bad things happen. But 20% of this nation is on anxiety medicine. It's pretty amazing, isn't it? We live in a very anxious-filled world. It's a very broken world. It's a world that desperately needs Jesus. Fear, worry, dread, despair, all common language in America, isn't it? Those words, we hear them. I don't remember hearing them as a kid. I just don't. I'm not saying that it didn't happen. I just don't remember it that much. But it does speak to where we are. We're in a world that is hateful, mean-spirited, and very, very depressed. Yet we have the light, if we're Christians, within us. We have the answer, yet maybe we're holding it to ourselves. If there's one thing that the world, I think if you could put it into one word, it would be fear. We are very fearful. We're fearful that we will lose our place, that we'll lose what's comfortable to us. We're fearful that we will, someone will come up against us. We're fearful about so many things, what others will think. We'll disappoint other people for the unknown. Think about all the things that fear is bringing into. And we say it in this area of fear. Children are fearful today. Man, when I was a kid, this was my mom's exact words, get out of the house. You can come back when it's supper time. And she didn't care where I went, as long as I was out of the house. Boy, now it is a time where we see it very much, like we just did the Halloween, you know, trunk or treat. Did you know parents, younger generation, will bring their kids? You know why the churches, you know why it's so packed now with kids? Because they trust us. And they bring the kids here. They don't send them out like they used to. Very few kids are hitting the streets. You'll only go to houses that you know. You don't go to anybody else's houses. It's fear. Fear has gripped us in this nation. And we all have that. Yet the Bible says, love casts out fear. We are continuing our series of All We Need Is Love. Anyway, you guys didn't do it for me. And this week, we'll be in 1 John 4:16 and all the way through chapter 5, 6. I believe today's message is so relevant, especially when we're talking about this holiday season. Because there's one thing about this holiday season. It has been stolen from Jesus. And expectations has been placed on everyone. That makes it not a joyful season, but a season of dread. A season of man, am I going to get the perfect gift? Am I going to be able to find something for this person or for that person? They already have everything. We think about all these things that matter none. And it builds all this stress and anxiety in our lives. If you're a Christian, this season should not be about Santa. It should be about the perfect gift. The gift that was given to us by God Himself. Amen. This season is about the birth of Jesus. Amen. It's about God's perfect gift to mankind. You can't outdo that gift. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, our one and only begotten Son, for those of you that are still in the King James. That's how I memorized it. Like to this day, I don't want to hear, don't tell me about clothes. It's got to be swaddling clothes. If it's not swaddling clothes, I don't want to hear the Christmas story. Because there's just something about swaddling clothes. It's got to be swaddling clothes. I don't know what swaddling clothes is, but you got to say it. There are just some things about Christmas that we got to remember that this is about Jesus. 1 John 4:15 through 16 says this, whosoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him, and he in God. I would say that's the way. So we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is love. And whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. I would say that's the truth. By this is love perfected with us, so that we may have confidence for the day of judgment. Because as he is, so also are we in the world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment. And whoever fears has not been perfected in love. We love because he first loved us. That's life. For Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, right? And no one comes to the Father except through him. Jesus is the giver and the perfecter of life. The first thing I want you to notice is Jesus is not only the giver of life, he's the perfecter of life. And he's the perfecter of love. And if Jesus, and if we're Christians, if we believe that Jesus is God's Son, if we have confessed our sins and asked Jesus into our heart, then we have perfect love residing within us. This is basic truth of the gospel. Secondly, I want you to notice that Jesus is our security. Man, we put our security in so much stuff, don't we? In our money, in our stuff. That's our security. That security is going to pass away. That's not security at all. Our only security is in Jesus Christ. I honestly hope we take the judgment seriously. The Bible says that someday every one of us will stand before God and we will give an account for our life. The only thing that will get us into heaven is our relationship with Jesus. The Bible also says that Jesus is coming back when we least expect it, in a twinkling of an eye. And when that happens, all those who are in him are drawn up to him. All those who are not are left. It's called the rapture. It's going to happen. And it will happen someday. The Bible says those that are left behind are going to go through tremendous heartache and pain and all kinds of, you can get into Revelation, it gets pretty dark. It gets pretty rough. And they're going to have to go through that if they don't have that. When I was a kid, we used to have these drills. And I don't think they do it anymore. I think they do it, they call it for tornadoes or whatever. But when we were a kid, it was about nuclear war. Do you remember that? We used to line up against the wall with our head like that would do anything. Like that's going to keep us from dying in a nuclear war. But we put our heads and our down on our knees and don't look at the light. Remember that? If you look into the light, like somehow that's going to save us as little kids. But we would go there and it was so fearful. The Russians were building up their nuclear arsenal. We were building up ours. It was going to be this Armageddon thing that was going to happen. We were all fearful of it, that someday nuclear war was going to wipe out everybody on the planet. And we were going to survive because we were at a wall with our hands behind our head. But other than us, but there's this fear that was in it, wasn't there? You know, if nuclear war head did go off, there would be thousands, depends on where it went out, maybe millions that died. That's a maybe. Can I tell you about a sure thing? Jesus is coming back. And he will rapture his people home. And those that are not with him will be left behind. Millions will be left behind. But you that are in Christ Jesus, there's no fear, for you will be drawn up to him in the sky and be united. That's the security that John's talking about. He's saying when that day comes, when that day of judgment comes, we can stand before the Father and say, listen, I was a mess, but I believed in your Son who bore upon himself my sins. And because of that, that's the only reason that I could ever even enter into this perfect paradise called heaven. And God will say, right answer, come on in. Come on in. It's crazy that a fear of a nuclear bomb wiping out thousands of people made us as kids scared to death. We were doing all kinds of things, the vivid memories of all this and the fears that was in there. Yet there are no fear about all those that are left behind. We've kind of forgot about it. You don't hear about that anymore. I think this is, I'm preaching on kind of the rapture, and that's kind of what it's talking about, but I can't even tell you the last time I really heard anybody preach on this. We just don't think about that anymore. I'm not sure if there will ever be a nuclear disaster, but I'm absolutely positive there will be a rapture. On that day, God will judge those, the good, the bad, those who have accepted him and those who have not. John 14:17 says there will be judgment. But if you're a Christian, if you have given your life to Jesus, you don't need to fear it. The Bible says that those who are in Christ Jesus will rise to meet him in the sky. We don't have to fear it. We look forward to it. Someday, all the pain, all the suffering will be gone. All the fear, all the anxiety, all that stuff will be gone. Those that are left behind, that's a different story. In fact, there'll be millions that are left behind. The Bible says, wide is the road that leads to destruction, but very narrow is the gate that leads to salvation. And very few will enter it. That should scare us. That's the part that should scare us as Christians. Because God gave us a responsibility. Do you know that? There's only one plan that Jesus gave. That was it. He said, you go tell. It's up to us. We're the ones that have to go out and share with our neighbors and our friends and everyone that is behind. I know that it can be daunting whenever we think about sharing our faith with people and the fear. But shouldn't there be more fear of the people we love, our family, the ones we care about, not making it into heaven? I'm thinking that's what should scare us. That's where the fear should reside. There's a word that's a bit confusing in this, and it says, by this love is perfected in us. As if something God made was imperfect and it's going to become perfect. It's not about that at all. I believe it relates back to John 4:12. No man has ever seen God. If we love one another, his love is perfected in us. Because there's an action that comes with love. There's an action that we should do. And because of who we are, if we're Christians, then the Holy Spirit is in us. And if the Holy Spirit is in us, then we should draw all men unto him. It's the Holy Spirit that convicts people and draws them to himself, which means within us, we have the ability to share the gospel and people receive it and give their life over. The word perfect is teleleo, which is a strange word. It can be translated in other places, completed. Like James 2:22, you see, faith was active along with works, and faith was completed by his works. When we care enough for humanity that we're willing to share our faith, it's completed. God's perfect plan is completed when we're willing to do what God calls us to do. Yet, I'm not so sure we're willing to do that. I think we put that on the back burner. Yeah, what will people think about us? well, I'm not really good at that. That's not my gift. If you're a Christian, it's your responsibility. It's my responsibility. It's all of our responsibility to do it. Teleleo, to be complete. God's love is complete. It has reached its goal. It has finished its work when it is shared with others, and they receive it unto themselves. When he says that we should show our love to our neighbor, what God is requesting us to do is accomplished. It's perfected whenever we share with our neighbor. That's what the Bible says in John 13, 14, a new commandment I give you, that you should love one another just as I have loved you. Verse 35, by this everyone will know that you are my disciples. James expands on the concept of perfect love in verses 18. Or John does in 18, 19. He says, there is no fear in love, but perfect, teleleo, love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not been perfected. We love because he loved us. Love casts out fear, and love is perfected when we share that love. The worst thing that can happen to us is what? We die? Is that really the worst thing? No. The worst thing is what happens after we die. If we don't have Jesus Christ into our life, the Bible says that we'll be eternally separated from God in a place called hell. And the Bible spends more time talking about hell than it does heaven. It's so bad. He's like, listen, I'm telling you, this is not somewhere you want to go. That's the worst thing that can happen. It's not death. It's not somehow being separated from our family. It's living forever and ever and ever and ever separated from God, separated from all that is good. Verse 17 says, you have no need to fear because perfect love casts out fear. We don't have to worry about being punished for our sins because Jesus paid for them throughout all eternity. Through God's completed plan, Jesus gave his life on a cross. The Bible says it is his blood that wipes away our sin, that washes away our sin, that we are purified, that we can stand before God as Jesus sees us, not as the simple person that we are. Love is shown by us sharing this with other people. Verse 20 and 21 says this, if anyone says, I love God and hates his brother, he's a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he can see or whom he has seen cannot love God who he has not seen. And this commandment we have from him, whoever loves God must love his brother. Love is an action. If I said, I love my wife, and I did hateful things toward my wife, do you believe that she would think that I loved her? Probably not. I know not. If I said on my wedding day, I'll be true to you and you'll be my one and only, and I would have a bunch of others, would that be loving her? No. If I said to my neighbor, I love you, my friend, but then speak bad about him to everybody that's around, is that loving my neighbor? If I said I love God and I have hate in my heart for other people because they don't align with me politically, socially, economically, does that make me a liar? How is it that I'm showing love if all I say is hateful things? If I said to my neighbor, if you need anything, let me know, and then know my neighbor is going through a difficult time and is in need and do nothing? How is that showing love? If we know our neighbor is not a Christian, and we know in a short time, and it could be short, there's some stuff happening in a place where a lot of stuff's supposed to happen according to the Bible. In a short time, Jesus may come back and we don't share with them the plan of salvation, are we loving our neighbor? If I know someone's in need, struggling to make it, and they need a break from their kids or a date night or spouse or even a place to stay, and I do not offer it to them, am I showing love to my neighbor? Love is an action. It requires something. And Jesus is our example. And through his sacrifice, we have the right to be called children of God. We learned that last week. We are God's children. We should act like it. I think a few of us are getting punished because we haven't been acting like it. Love is an action, and Jesus is our example. And through his sacrifices, we have the right to be called children of God. It really was Jesus that made love possible. Chapter 5, verse 1. Everyone who believes that Jesus Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of him. By this we know that we love the children of God. When we love God and obey his commandments, for this is love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes in the Son of God? Isn't that a great passage, a great reminder that this world, all of its complications, all of its sorrow, all of its transgressions, all of its struggles, we have overcome it. Jesus overcome the world, so we have overcome it. There is only one way to true love, and that's through Jesus Christ, our Son. Kind of like whenever I showed with the kids. You know, we are an empty vessel without a battery, just like that flashlight. It is God's love. It's God that enters into that flashlight that gives us life and love and care. It is God who comes out of us, who overflows us to those around us, that makes things possible. I think when I think back in John chapter 3, verse 2, whenever Nicodemus says, Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. Jesus answered him, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you've been born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. There's only one way to heaven. You must be born again. We are born of the flesh and of the spirit, right? He told Nicodemus that. Nicodemus was like, what are you talking about? Can't do that. I'm a little big now. Mom's going to scream. And he says, no, I'm not talking about that. You were born once, flesh. But there's a new thing you have to be, and that's born of the Spirit. And that only comes through Jesus Christ, giving your life to Jesus Christ. You have a new birth. You have a new birthday whenever you do that. Jesus said in 14:16, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Right? No one comes to the Father except through me. Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That's what the verse 1 means. When we talk about being born of God, we are born through God, through the blood of Jesus. He has washed away our sins, nothing but the blood of Jesus, right? When you accept the sacrifice of Jesus, there's a promise that you will be called a child of God. Amen. It's no longer your life, it's his life. Therefore, if we're going to live out our life, if we're going to complete our life, we're going to teleo our life, we have got to live out the calling that he put on our life. John says, if you have love, it will be shown through your obedience. By this, we know that we love the children of God when we love God and obey his commandments. And my commandments are not burdensome. I think back in my life, there's a verse that I memorized one time. It's in Proverbs 15. And it says this, folly brings joy to the one who has no sense. Which I think is kind of funny, you know, because that was me most of my life. I was just a foolish person who had no sense. I thought humor and just enjoying life was what life was all about. Folly brings joy to the one who has no sense. But he who has direction keeps a straight path. That's really what life was about. And I think about that verse in my life. If I had not gotten wound up in the foolishness of life, and I had kept the straight path, man, I'm telling you, there are things that I wished I wouldn't have done that I wouldn't have done. There are people that I hurt that I would have never hurt. There are things that I hold to this day and regret that I wouldn't have regret over if only I kept the straight path instead of being in the foolishness of life. It's hard. It's hard on everyone whenever we get wrapped up in foolishness. I believe our sin breaks the heart of God. I believe he's up there going, man, I had such wonderful things for you. I really wished you hadn't done that. That's going to bring pain and heartache later on. You're going to deal with stuff. Man, I really wished you would have stayed on the right path. It breaks my heart that you've made these choices. I'm amazed whenever people say, why does God allow bad things to happen? God doesn't cause bad things to happen. Sin causes bad things to happen. When we ask, well, I can't believe that God isn't coming and rescuing me from this pit that I put myself in. Yeah, you put yourself in. And we don't recognize that. We think God is going to somehow has a magic wand and goes, and your life is all better. God requires action. We have got to fulfill that action that he calls us to do. And we can walk up out of the pit, but it's not going to just naturally disappear. That's not the way God works. I believe God's heart breaks along with ours whenever a child is hurt, when a family is broken, when loved ones are facing health concerns. I believe God's heart is broken. The Bible tells us that in this broken and sinful world, we will have trouble. But he also says, I've overcome this world. As long as we're in this world, we're going to have trouble. As long as we're in this sinful world, there are going to be things that are going to hurt. There are going to be things that are disappointing. Our short time on this earth is nothing compared to forever. All eternity, not in a broken world where we're told we're not in a broken world where we're told there will be no more suffering, no more pain, in a place where we sit in God, we listen to angels sing, the tears are wiped from our eyes, in the beauty of heaven someday. But not here, not in this world. We've rebelled, we've turned against God, we've created this mess. We, simple human beings, have created. And it is not until Jesus calls us home will we ever escape all the heartache and sorrow that is around us. Yet, we don't have to be fearful. Because we know, when this is over, glory begins. What a wonderful thing to think about. Verse 5 says, That overcomes the world, except the one who believes in Jesus, the Son of God. In other words, it's up to us. Do we believe or not? And I'm not just saying, do we believe in God? The devil believes in God. Have we given our life over to him? I mean, do we really believe? And do we believe what we say we believe? You know, a lot of us have a kind of a multiple personality. We come in around Christians and we act one way. And we're around the world and we act quite different. It's like we have two different personalities. Are we truly giving our life over to God? Have we truly said, Lord, you take my life? Well, I was baptized as a baby. Well, that's nice. It's not going to save you, but that's nice. Well, I went to confirmation classes. Okay, well, that's good too. I'm glad you learned some stuff. Still not going to save you. You say, well, I was raised in church and I go to church every single Sunday. Okay, that's good too. I'm glad you're here. It's not going to save you. There's only one thing that will save you. There's only one thing that matters, and that is you confessing to God, listen, I'm a sinner. I need a Savior. I need someone to take my sins upon them. I need you to come into my life and take over and help me to become who you want me to be. That's the only thing that matters, is whenever we truly turn our lives over to Him. For those who believe in Jesus and have put their faith in Him, they are the ones that are the overcomers. Because it's no longer you that's in charge. You've given your life over. It's now God that's in charge. And let Him lead you and guide you. Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to You today. Lord, as an empty vessel, Lord, much like that flashlight that we did with the kids, where, Lord, it needs something in it that we just can't do ourselves. And we know that that's You. And we've come here from all different areas. We all have different things going on in our lives, Father God, but we all desperately need You. So, Father God, I pray, if there's one here today who does not know You as Lord and Savior, that today will be the day that they say, simple prayer, just simple, Lord, I'm a sinner. Forgive me. Come into my heart, Lord, save me. Lord, something that simple has eternal consequences. So, Father God, if we believe in our heart that this is true, we believe in You, and we give our life over to You, then we are overcomers. Fear has no control over us. For You have given us peace, and the peace which passes understanding. So, Father God, I pray that this Christmas season we'll focus on You and not all this junk in the world. And we just pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Please stand and join us for one more song this morning.
Did you know that your baby boy Monday walked on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy could save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you deliver, he'll soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God.
The blind will see,
the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of heaven's perfect land, and the sleeping child.